Welcome back, everyone. The D&D boys have joined me here, and let's talk about Super Hot Crew's win in that last match. Whew, what a game it was yet again. So let's take it all the way back to the beginning to freshen our minds. Deficio, who do you think got the best coming out of the draft?
Well, first of all, Lee and I upstairs, or D-Man and I upstairs, were talking about their Nidalee first rotation pick from Fnatic, which is a bit weird. Like, normally you save it for later on, you don't necessarily have to lock it in instantly. It must have been because they were expecting Selfie to pick it up, or Super Hot Crew to pick it up, and it simply meant, because they picked Nidalee so early, Kale went over to Super Hot Crew, Twitch went over to Super Hot Crew, Thresh, of course, was the first pick for We Will Fail Us, so they got so many strong picks, and so many picks they have played before and love to play.
And it's weird because this isn't the first time we've seen Nidalee as a first pick, even for Peke, or more importantly, Peke having the first pick for Fnatic. Sometimes it works, sometimes it backfires, and when you're, what, 3 wins, 4 losses now, perhaps he needs to start looking at the team comp. I don't know what they saw in it. I mean, we haven't seen dominant Nidalee so far this season at all.
I think the idea behind the comp was you have Elise and Nami as like the disengage to help the Kog'Maw in the back, and of course the Nidalee in the back just... Yeah. Flying away, and you can siege towers very effectively because, again, you have long range to hit the towers. You can land the spears, poke all the time. I think that was the general idea, and then Trundle, of course, to split push against Shyvana.
And you mentioned if dominating Nidalee performances last week, that was Fnatic's good pick in that, so maybe they wanted to go back that for comfort. Let's talk about after draft, getting into the game. Which team had the best plan going into the early game? Because it was pretty close for a long time.
Well, it was pretty obvious Super Hot Crew were looking more for objectives than straight up team fights. And you have to go back as well to the Fnatic point, actually, with the way they played the comp. One thing I have to highlight, and one thing they did really well compared to All-Star, also in the early game, was when Mr. Rallis was farming a lane by himself, they would actually group up 5 members with the Nidalee, with, of course, also Reckless, to just poke away on a tower. And it worked for them. They got first blood, they got the tower in mid lane, while Mr. Rallis was stuck in the bot lane. So that's one thing they did with the comp. There was a whole idea behind it, to group up and just start sieging down a tower. But then because Subaru Crew could manage to just hold off and continue to farm and just take objectives, they were always in the game.
Yeah, we just heard Mr. Rallis talking about it. You know, he was just saying, it's unusual. We were getting objective control. This was not a planned thing. However, as Trevor pointed out many, many times during that game, they constantly pushed the waves. And of course, when you've got a Shyvana, when you've got a Kayle, when you've got a Twitch in there, you can clear those waves very quickly. And that's why they were just constantly pushing wave after wave into Fnatic.
Exactly. And also, when you're against Trundle, who can wave clear very fast, Nidalee as well is the same deal. Yes, if there's nobody around her, she can go into Kuka form, clear the wave. Otherwise, she can't. So it's very easy for Super Hot Crew to just push multiple lanes, group together so they had all the pressure on the side lanes and group 5 in the middle, and therefore just move between the lanes later on to just pick up towers.
So what do we do with the late game? Do we give props to Fnatic for being able to hold it off? And do we question SAC's ability to close it out, or was it just a ticking time bomb?
Honestly, for me, the game went slightly longer because Impaler got a little edgy. If you think about it, it was when they went for Peke in the mid lane. We saw it was Mr. Rallis alongside him, and then it flashed and counter-flashed straight away. If they'd have caught Peke then, possibly could have ended the game right there because they'd have taken the inhib, which they did. But then, of course, that's when Fnatic caught them out. Some great pillars of ice coming out of SOS, locked them up, managed to clear them out. They got the Baron. Then they took about 2 towers as well, Fnatic. That's what kind of brought Fnatic back in, and that's what really made it the longest game in the summer split so far. But after that, again, they couldn't do anything because they had no wave clear, or suddenly not enough wave clear to compete with Super Hot Crew.
So some final words maybe about the state of Super Hot Crew right now. We've hammered on it in the pre-show now again, but I think it is justified that we are quite hyping them up at this moment, Fisho.
Oh, of course. I mean, again, look at the game here. Once they actually got into team fights as a group, they were stronger than Fnatic. The comp as well, in my opinion, was stronger than Fnatic's comp when it comes to team fights, mainly because you compare Kale to the Nidalee pick, where Kale really wins out big time in the team fights. So once we saw Super Hot Crew actually play safe and group up, it worked for them. They were just too over-aggressive. Not only at the point you mentioned where Peke flashed away, not only did they flash for it, they also used both ultis from Evelynn and Twitch to try and kill her. So when the fight actually happened, they couldn't do anything. So as long as they can learn to not be over-aggressive, they play really well.
I think it took them a while to realize, actually, we are much stronger in team fights. I mean, when you've got a Shyvana that can jump in, make him invulnerable, pounce on her, rat-a-tat-tat from the side, Hurricane, everything coming out of Selfie, they should have dominated the team fights. And there was also a team fight where Selfie went for Soaz, when Reckless was right at the side of him. If it had took Reckless down, they could have easily pushed on and finished again. So multiple times, if they're going to look back at this, which they will, they've got an analyst, they will see a couple of mistakes that were easy to clean up and suddenly realize, actually, we're really strong. We've just taken down Fnatic, who have won this seasons three times running.
Absolutely. Incredibly impressive by the Super Hot Crew. We will join Joe and Quickshot at the desk in a moment for our next match. But first, let's hear what the Copenhagen Wolves' AD carry Woolite thinks about facing Gambit and his former teammate, Nick.
Gambit is the most random team I've ever seen in my life. Like, one day they can beat everyone, and the other day they will lose to the worst team. So they're unpredictable. Now they have a new mid laner who I played with in my last team, Denial. He's good, but not one of the best mid laners in Europe. So.
Welcome back to the Casades, everyone. It's time for our next game where the Copenhagen Wolves are going to take on Gambit. Both of these teams are currently tied in seventh position with a 2-4 record and are going to be looking to improve upon those rocky opening week performances. For the Wolves, I expect they may be heading back to a little bit more standard types of champions if they're looking to pick up wins, which of course everyone's here to do.
Yeah, specifically in their top lane. You know, the Wolves are 0-4 when they play AP top laners. Two of the games, we've also seen them running Yorick in the jungle, which is not particularly strong at the moment. I haven't seen it deliver. But I do feel the Wolves need to work on their pick and ban strategy overall because their team comp's always a little odd. Youngbuck in particular, I think he needs to decide on his champion pool. In the 6 games he's played the split, he's racked up a third of his deaths that he played in the 28 games last split. He's not won a single game when playing an AP top laner. 2 losses on Lulu, 2 losses on Vladimir, makes him 0-4. But then you compare him with his tanks, he's gone 1-16-15 on those AP champions. And then you look at his Trundle and Shyvana game, 3-6-28. For me, it's very important for the Wolves to get Youngbuck on a tank or a champion where he can actually contribute positively to the rest of their team comp. We'll have to see how picks and bans goes for them.
Completely agree with you on that one. On the other side, though, Gambit will once again be playing with Nick, and he is of now, of course, an official member of Gambit that was announced recently. And the fact is they managed to bounce back against Fnatic and secure a win and really pushed Alliance very hard before eventually losing out. Good signs for Gambit overall.
Yeah, it is one of the few good signs, I'm afraid, because they hold a lot of unwanted records and that's going to need to change if Gambit want to climb up the ladder and try to be present at the World Championship for a third year running. I do want to talk about the team's KDA and run through each of the players. It's not a pretty picture. Darien currently holds the lowest EU KDA for top lane. Diamond has the lowest KDA for jungle. Nick has the lowest KDA for mid. I think you're seeing a trend here. Edward has got the second lowest KDA for support, and Genja is the third lowest for ADC. They are also the second highest when it comes to total deaths. The reason I rattle off KDA for everybody is because the fact of the matter is they die too often. They've all been responsible for being caught out, and they need to stop giving up those unnecessary deaths like they did against Fnatic. Because when they don't give up those kills and don't give away that gold, they do find ways to win games. So it's very important for me for them to not make those individual mistakes.
Darien does hold also the record for the most manly swag teleport coming out of their games last week.
Out of Europe. Kobe would say otherwise for North America.
Well, guys, we'll see if Darien can pull any more of them beauties off here today. Well, let's first of all check out the starting lineups for this game. On the blue side, we have the Copenhagen Wolves with Youngbuck in the top lane, Airwax in the jungle, Kautard in the mid lane, Woolite the AD carry, and Unlimited the support.
And on the red side, it is Gambit, Darien up top, Diamond in the jungle, Nick in the mid lane, Genja playing AD carry, and Edward on support.
So let's check out your votes for this game once again. According to lolesports.com, you predicted that Gambit are going to win this match by 67%. And I think if we consider the improvements, certainly some improvements that Gambit have made over the last couple of weeks, that might not be too far away from the truth.
Going to be a tough game to see. Both of these teams have had positive moments. Both of these teams have had not so positive moments,
I think it's negative.
The word I'm going to go for. But I do think there's going to be a massive priority on Evelynn. Evelynn was first picked by Airwax. It is far and away his strongest jungler that we have seen in the LCS. 2 games on Lee, 2 games on Yorick, 2 games on Eve. And last week, his Evelynn was largely responsible for their victory. So if Gambit don't ban it away, I do see being first picked by the Wolves.
I think a lot of Wolves fans right now, please no Yorick. Please no Yorick.
Wolves fans, everyone watching.
That's another thing to add into it as well. And he's just not had the impact on that champion. you know, you can be on a comfort champion all you like, but if it's not a champion that brings you results, you've got to move away and find another comfort champion that's going to bring you the wins.
Just to quickly throw it out there, Airwax is quite confident that if you find 1v1 in the jungle, that Yorick is very strong early game. But then he needs to actually play around that style, which we haven't seen him do when he has run that Yorick in the past.
Totally agree. We're into picks and bans here between the Wolves and Gambit Gaming. First bans out from the Copenhagen Wolves pretty quick, and looks like we're, I was going to say, all focus on the mid lane, but of course, Gragas ain't a mid laner anymore. He's Eddie's big bad support player.
And you've seen Eddie throw his hands up in the air. He's played a lot of Gragas, and his Gragas is very good in that support role. The amount of disruption it offers is very powerful. We've also seen Eddie fall back to Nami last week. I wasn't particularly impressed by his Aqua Prisons, but he had one or two good tidal waves, so we need to see if he can have a higher impact with the Nami if he goes that route. But Thresh is still up. Zyra is still up. There's a number of supports that both Unlimited and Edward can pick from if they go that route.
Quickly touch here on the rest of the bans, because they did come quickly in this one. Of course, a red side ban for Kassadin. Evelynn, which we mentioned, a high priority target for the two junglers in this one. Airwax and Diamond. Yasuo taken away from Kautard, who's brought some very strong performances overall, both here in summer and in the spring split as well. The final ban out for the Copenhagen Wolves was towards Darien's Jax, which, whilst Jax is always a problem, he's never had particularly amazing appearances on it. However, did secure them a win against Fnatic, and he was the one, you know, the bad early game for Gambit. He gets going later on.
He pulled it back in the late game very well. With the Jax being banned out and knowing both Youngbuck and Darien, I almost inspect a Shyvana Trundle matchup for that top lane. It could be Irelia as well. Remember, Darien has played Irelia this split already. Not necessarily to the greatest of effect, but there are options. But there's still a lot of very powerful picks on the board. LeBlanc is still up if we want to see that route being played. But we've also seen the likes of Orianna coming out from Nyx. So a lot of tools, and it just depends whatever comp Gambit want to run.
And Lulu, also a big pick for Gambit in the last two games, was played by Nyx. Before that, though, he had a whole mix of champions in there. Either way, Twitch was the first pickup for Woolite here, and he's already proven that he is handy with the Rat, playing once this season against the Super Crew. On the other side, though, it looks like Gambit may be looking to take away Ziggs from Kautard. That will be locked in, and we wouldn't be surprised with a Lee Sin pickup for Diamond with the Evelynn off the table.
So it's interesting to see the Ziggs sort of denial from Kautard, because he's 0-2 on that champion this split. It is something that Kautard played a very large amount of during the spring split, and of course all of the defensive power that it gives you. But with Eve being banned away and Lee Sin being stolen from Airwax, we're going to see him on potentially Yorick if he's going to go to a champion we've seen, or he may have to play something different. We've seen a Kha'Zix ban earlier today. Kha'Zix is still being played in the jungle, but we've seen him in the mid lane from North America. So I'm not quite sure what Airwax is going to go to unless he wants to pick out something like the Nunu, something like the Jarvan or whatever, which are other potentials, but not very realistic, I'm afraid.
Or Yorick.
Yeah, it's going to be Yorick, I think.
We'll see. Shyvana taken here for the top lane. Darien has faced Shyvana twice so far this split and actually played Jax both times, which of course is already banned away this game. So, as you mentioned, likelihood of a Shyvana lane, that's what we're going to call it from now on, seems very likely. Also, the Thresh taken for Unlimited.
It could also be Irelia. Darien has the option available, played it twice. He does have a win under his belt already. But this is a very slow pick and ban phase from both of these teams. The way Edward reacted when that Gragas was banned out makes me think he wasn't anticipating it, was not ready for that. So there's a lot of discussion going on between the rest of the Gambit members. Nick doesn't look too phased by this. He's got his champion theoretically locked in. If this Kale is locked, that's going to be a support Kale, unless Gambit pulls something way out the hat. But support Kale in Rated has run it in the past, has been fairly successful with it. And there is so much damage on the side of Gambit. Not a lot of hard crowd control, but they've just DPS all the way down the line.
Looking happy with his choice there as well. Lucian, of course, locked in for Genja. Twitch against Lucian, a matchup which we're seeing so often these days. And, well, I say matchup, we're seeing them more often than not in opposite lanes. However, for the Copenhagen Wolves, final two picks here. Looking for Airwax's jungle choice. As we said before, Evelynn has been banned out. Kha'Zix still up there, but at least up there with the top four junglers right now will be locked in for the Copenhagen Wolves.
So with the Lulu lock in for Countout as well, you've got a very standard composition. There's some powerful engage from a Shyvana plus a Lulu ultimate. You can find picks with Death Sentence and Elise. You can ambush people with the Twitch. The reason Countout's going to be happy for this Lulu, he's got one game played, one win, a 27 KDA on that champion. He had a phenomenal, phenomenal performance the last time we've seen him play that Lulu. And for Gambit, that may mean it's top lane Kayle. And, Defish is going to be very disappointed in me. Top lane Kayle is a thing against Shyvana at the moment. It's something that a lot of the European LCS teams are playing in scrims, and a few top laners have actually spoken to us and talked about how Kayle against Shyvana is very strong, because if Shyvana jumps on you and you're at risk of dying, intervention saves your life. The move speed increase from Kayle and the slow onto Shyvana then gives you tools to shred all of his bonus armor and MR, and you can keep kiting away thanks to your Righteous Fury. Leona is going to be locked in. That's going to be a top lane Kayle. Has to be.
Top lane Kayle coming in then for Darien. And whilst we were talking about Youngbuck and his relatively unsuccessful times, let's call it, with AP top laners, we're going to be seeing Darien running that Kayle. I'm very interested to see how he does with that one. Edward, of course, then will take the Leona into the lane with Lucian on the other side up against Twitch and Thresh.
So both of these comps do very well at defending sieges. They've got a lot of natural wave clear that they can work with. Lulu can do a good job under towers. Ziggs is obviously going to do a great job. There is more potential for Copenhagen Wolves to find picks thanks to their abilities, thanks to the Twitch, thanks to Lulu, thanks to Thresh. However, if they get grouped up and Gambit, like, initiate a fight quickly with a good solar flare and have Kayle and Ziggs in there, their AoE damage potential is through the roof. So the Copenhagen Wolves need to be very careful to not get caught clumped up, to not run the risk of being caught by a multi-man solar flare. If that happens, they will get melted. And there's a lot of emphasis, I think, on Nick. If his bouncing bombs and minefields are not strong in these sort of skirmishes and lane phases, there's a lot of pressure on Edward as well. So no room for error, I feel, for Gambit's composition.
Just going to go and put it out there, be that guy to do it. Intervention for Darien could help save his KDA right now, especially if he goes for any of those crazy teleports. Well, guys, now that picks and bans are in, do you still think that Gambit have the edge? You can tweet to us, #CWWin or #GMBWin to @LOLEsports, and we'll see if you guys changed your minds coming around. And I've got a feeling a few of you may just have with the a little bit off-the-cuff picks here for Gambit.
Yeah, I mean, this top lane Kayle is something that has been talked about, and it is something that is being used in scrims by the European teams. Now we get to see it, in the Swag Lord's hands himself, and we'll see how it performs.
Well, we are going to see right now, because we're getting into game as the Copenhagen Wolves take on Gambit Gaming. As we said before, both of these teams struggling really in the league with 2 wins and 4 losses to their name. One of them will be coming out with a lead in the table, though, after this matchup takes place. And wonder if we'll see anything here at level one. Not sure, to be honest, that we will.
No, I'm not so convinced. If Unlimited or Edward are to start something, yeah, there is some crowd control to play with. But we've seen defensive starts from everybody. I'm more interested to see if Gambit want to initiate a lane swap. Putting a Lucian Leona into a Twitch Thresh lane could be very punishing. But on the same token, the theory is that Kayle is somewhat of a counter to Shyvana. So it looks like we're going to be going for those straight-up matchups. And I think Diamond may be putting some pressure on Genji and Edward's lane.
66 to 34%. I believe it was 68% before, so
67 to 33 in the original vote.
So I was right.
Enough.
One person, possibly, has decided that the Copenhagen Wolves are going to be taking this one. We'll find out, though, guys. Of course, coming into the back of this one after a amazing game in our last one between the Super Hot Crew and Fnatic. We'll see if this one can live up to the latter half of today's game.
So we talked about how we may not have level one shenanigans. I'm going to retract my vote and say there may be the possibility, because Airwax has actually started with the machete, a pot, and a pink ward. You can see some support from the rest of the Wolves moving towards this area of the map. And the lane swap initiation has started from the Copenhagen Wolves. Whether they wanted or whether they anticipated a lane swap themselves is the other question. Death Sentence onto Diamond. This could be scary.
Oh, Diamond going to come around the side from this one already. The damage starts, but can they lock him down? Youngbuck will actually chase him away from the jungle completely. And the Copenhagen Wolves are going to be getting themselves a red buff from the enemy jungle here for the start. We'll see how Gambit can react to this one. Airwax will smite that one away, and the Wolves will get back off into lanes. Right now, it's actually left Woolite alone in the top lane to have free reign on the farm on that top side of things. Of course, Darien will be joining his jungler for a route around the jungle, and the Copenhagen Wolves appearing in mid lane with four men. There's a flay onto Nick. It's not going to be close enough or further enough away from the turret to have an impact, though.
So, Unlimited not able to get in range and diamond for that red buff invade. Unfortunately, skilling up flay means there was no kill potential. The Copenhagen Wolves, with the support Thresh, there's roaming. This is the third game in a row that we've seen this Thresh in the very, very early stages of the game moving around the map with the rest of his team. It's given Copenhagen Wolves a buff advantage for the time being. The one thing we need to keep our eyes on is how long that pink ward lasts in Gambit's red buff. It was put down by Airwax after they'd forced Gambit away to ensure that Gambit didn't have vision for a potential steal. And the longer that lasts, the better the investment is, because that's quite an expensive item or decision just to get one buff. But Airwax, for the time being, is in a pretty good position. He's got that early lead we talked about, and there is still that vision in the jungle.
Yeah, three buff start here for the Copenhagen Wolves. That pink ward survived because Gambit didn't go far enough north from that. And the TP actually coming in here from Youngbuck down into this bottom lane.
So
he's going to give him certainly the experience. We'll see how much farm he actually gets out of this one, but that should leave him in an advantage, or possibly not. If he doesn't see this one coming early enough, he's in danger. There are four men from Gambit coming around now.
Yeah, Edward's looking for Youngbuck. So Youngbuck's been pushed away from the gold and the experience of that massive minion wave. Airwax has come to support, but this is a 4v2, and they're just denying the experience. So all of that advantage that the Wolves gained as a team for Airwax has effectively been denied, but even greater scale from Youngbuck. That is a lot of minions and experience that was lost at this early stage in the game.
See Diamond actually being able to smite away the big round, big golem as Kowtard here collects another bouncing bomb to the face, didn't use his flash there. Obviously knew how much damage that was actually going to do to him and was able to walk away from the pressure. Meanwhile, Youngbuck trying to force Gambit away from this bottom tower, which has already been knocked down to just minute health.
It won't take a long time for Gambit to shove that down and actually open up the map. We see that Unlimited has responded to try and support Youngbuck. Similar situation to a lot of the games we're seeing these days where the AD carries are left to deal with their opponent's top laners. The only difference in this particular matchup is that a Kayle top lane will be much more difficult to farm safely against, because Kayle's going to have that ranged ability and may actually be able to trade with an AD carry a little more effectively in this earlier stages of the game with just her base abilities and base damages.
If you've been there right now, Darien is actually having a go at Kowtard in this mid lane and he knocked pretty much instantly down to just a third of his HP. Meanwhile, Woolite has let that wave push up completely onto him here and making sure that doesn't push back. So really wouldn't be much for Darien even if he went to this top lane.
Yeah, he wouldn't be able to get, he would need to farm unsafely is the phrase that I'm looking for. But an interesting start, Gambit responding to that roam in the rotation from the Copenhagen Wolves by applying pressure on the bottom lane. It did not yield results by the tower, and Airwax has now looked to invade and fortunately walked straight over a ward, but maybe if he pulled the trigger, could have got something from that. No tower dropped, and Genji and Edward are now in a sort of AD carry support versus top lane in support. Let's see how much poke Genji can get down, because he should have the advantage in this matchup.
And Diamond this entire time sticking around in the mid lane with Nick. Nick pretty much soaking up all of the farm from that one. But we can see there the levels, level 5 for Nick, level 3 for Darien, level 5 for Kowtard, and he's not quite at the halfway point to hitting level 6 just now. And you see there the pings and the wards that he's putting down, feeling rather unsafe having no vision of Diamond right now.
Yeah, I think for Darien in this matchup, he's opted to go for the holding Nick's hand to ensure he doesn't get ganked in that top lane. We've seen Darien fall behind in the laning phase often, and this is a 3v2 in the bottom. It's a very interesting shot. Edward has been a little caught out. This is a bit weird.
Yeah, I think made more of a mistake there as Kowtard again gonna get blasted by the bouncing bomb of Nick. One more will actually do it here. He needs to be very, very careful of how close he actually stays, as Genja does try and force Youngbuck to back away. Youngbuck actually himself taking more damage than he can dish out.
So Gambit have given up levels, farm, and experience on Darien in exchange for Woolite. Woolite has been farming solo, unchallenged and unopposed in this top lane for the entirety of this game. What Gambit has accomplished in exchange for that is a lot of damage on that bottom outer turret and the middle outer turret, but it hasn't actually resulted in any map control. AWACS decided to respond to the bottom lane pressure by pushing away to Gambit's tower. And this is a very awkward start to the game because Darien is just going to be delayed. He's behind on levels to Youngbuck by a little bit. He's down by about a third of the CS. And when he does eventually go to lane, Woolite is already level 6. If he does go and try face head, you know, head to head against Woolite, potentially, he runs the risk of getting in trouble. Alternatively, I mean, Darien and Nick, they've just been holding hands in this mid lane and they don't seem to show any signs of moving elsewhere.
Very interesting start here for Gambit Gaming. Youngbuck clearing out his wards. Where's he going to be going next? Diamond and the rest of Gambit actually making sure this blue buff doesn't get stolen away. That will, of course, be given over to Nick for his mid lane adventures. And he has hit level 6 now as well. So Kautard, he can't afford to be catching too many bombs, although he's also now at level 6 himself. So he'll be able to throw on that wild growth should he need to. This is interesting. Gambit going to be starting off the dragon. They are, however, stood right on top of the Copenhagen Wall to Wall.
Yeah, the thing is they've got so many members. Darien's just teleported into the mid lane. He's going to be looking to challenge. And there's a Mega Inferno bomb from Nick. So let's see how the engage plays out.
They're actually trying to keep them away here as Edward going to go in with the Zenny blade on towards Airwax. There's the calling coming out. Doesn't really connect onto anyone. Went almost directly down the middle of the two. Either way, the dragon did get taken. First dragon of the game for Gambit.
So they've invested heavily in controlling the bottom half of the map. And I would say from a map perspective, they have it. They have more damage in the Copenhagen Wolves towers. That bottom outer turret is just a breath away from being taken out. Darien is level 5 to Youngbuck's level 5, but he's down half of the CS. I have to give props to Genja, considering all that's been happening in that lane and the number of champions involved. He's actually almost even on CS with Woolite, who has been completely alone in that top lane. Woolite is basically playing a PvE matchup right now because nobody is getting in his face. Oh. The only thing is, Inferno Bomb from Nick? Does he need it? I think Nick's been very hesitant with that Inferno Bomb. But Gambit, again, they're focusing the towers. They're putting a lot of resources in getting this map play, and it looks to almost work. One more hit? Not this time.
No, not this time. Let's throw some damage more on towards Unlimited, trying to help defend. Woolite continues his lonely life in the top lane, but that lonely life brings him to close to 100 CS here and probably will be hitting 100 before he has any kind of challenge in that lane. Plus, he's already up at level 8.
Yeah, if you look at the CS and the gold values, there is so much money for both Genja and Woolite to spend. 2,600 gold for Woolite. So what that means, he's going to be so close to just instantly purchasing his Blade of the Rune King on his first back, and then he can leave the lane and start looking to ambush, start looking to find kills. If Gambit continue to play this very fast and loose game of roaming and rotating on the bottom two lanes of the map, it allows Woolite to potentially get kills. The thing is, he's not that far ahead. He's got a very small advantage over Genja. It's only the 7 CS. And Genja's got two turrets and a dragon to his name. So overall, Darien is somewhat down in experience, but he is up in gold thanks to those global objectives. And Gambit now deciding bottom half is boring. They've sent 4 members to the top lane. They want the sneaky rats.
And as if it was all free for him now, he's got 4 men coming in. There's the invisibility, but he's spotted by Lee Sin. But look at this, the reaction from the Copenhagen Wolves sending them away. Youngbuck has dove right in. Wild Growth will knock up 3. Can they get any kills here? The kick from Diamond will send Youngbuck away, and the bomb almost taking out Youngbuck while he goes. It was a good defense of Woolite, but will they be able to hold the tower?
I don't think they've got enough HP, and they can't run the risk because of the power of Ziggs. If Ziggs gets some good bombs, they're going to be in trouble. Luckily for the Copenhagen Wolves, Kautard was relatively healthy and still has his summoners. So the Glitter Lances is what we're going to be looking at to try and control these minion waves. Or Gambit are just not going to push that one at all. Going to decide to back away. So the first big engage, Gambit start the fight, peel away, and no casualties. But Copenhagen Wolves are down on items. It's still 3,200 gold for Woolite. We're finally going to see him spending it.
20,200 gold on his first back at level 12. At 12 minutes into the game, he's not quite level 12, although he's not even that far away. Level 9, and as you said, instant Blade of the Ruined King coming out from him. Question now is, what does he do with it? Does he have an opportunity to use that very early big major item?
In theory, yes. The way Gambit have been moving and the way Gambit have been focusing on the bottom half of the map, you could theorize that they will do the same focus the next time Dragon's up, and it should be a couple of minutes away. There is timing on Dragon. It's around the 14 and a half minute mark. So the Copenhagen Wolves should be looking to either push waves in their favor in the top and middle, and then group vision around Dragon. You can see Edward already just clearing out the wards, trying to get control. Because Darien's got teleport available, I think we can theorize at this point he's going to TP for that Dragon. And he's gone for an interesting build. Rushed the Berserker's Grease, and he's picked up a Chalice of Harmony very early on. So maybe looking to stick around in lane and cause troubles.
Youngbuck actually caught out of position completely here. Gonna take a lot of damage. They lock him up as he actually goes. There's the flash as well away from Edward's Solar Flare. And a little bit too far up lane there, I think, Youngbuck.
It was a little too extended. And that all stems from that very, very awkward and interesting early game play from Gambit. They forced the tower down, it made Youngbuck have to overextend, so Edward caught him from behind. The fact that Youngbuck's not going to have his flash available for the potential dragon fights in the next few minutes is a very good sign for Gambit. It just reduces the threat of a hard engage from Youngbuck because he won't have that escape available. And Gambit just continued this roam. Four members of the team in the red buff area of the Wolves, they're getting some deep vision. This should give them near absolute dragon control once it spawns in the middle.
Going to lose out on that top outer turret, but gain themselves a red buff at less than a minute's time, as you said, until Dragon comes in. That'll make Genger also feel a lot more safe down in the bottom lane to push up, knowing that his team control that area of the map as the bomb was used here. 5-6 just to clear out the wave. And Unlimited will push very heavily towards that inner turret. Let's not forget that Youngbuck, no ultimate available to him at this point, and used that flash during the last encounter, so he's a bit of a vulnerable person down on the bottom lane.
Gambit have set their sights on the inner turret. They forced Youngbuck away. He's not going to be able to defend. There's not enough minions, unfortunately, for Gambit to do any real damage. But look at Nick. He's shoving up the mid lane. The rest of Gambit pushing the bottom lane. And Diamond is just waiting. He's trying to respond. They've lost two turrets for this previous push, though. Gambit have not gained any big objectives, while Woolite and Unlimited, they know where their opponents are. Almost every member of Gambit was visible to the Copenhagen Wolves, so they've secured both of those top lane turrets. So a smart counterplay from the Copenhagen Wolves not to back off and not to run away.
There is the Dragon, started off by Diamond. Complete control they have of that one, and the Cullen actually going to be thrown out from Genger just to try and get them low enough.
But look at
will stop anything happening here. The Dragon goes down. Woolite and Unlimited continue to push there.
Like, there's nothing that Darien can do yet. If he gets caught by a death sentence, he's already used his intervention once. There's no damage and there's no kill threat. That's a level 10 Woolite to a level 7 Darien. Unlimited's got the same amount of levels as a solo top lane Kayle. We talked about the theory of Kayle doing well against Shyvana. Darien's never had a chance because he's been pushing the mid lane tower, and Woolite and Unlimited have got so much map presence in the top half of the Gambit's jungle.
And they finally sent Genger and Edward back into base there, and they didn't get that inner turret in the bottom lane. Woolite and Unlimited simply backed away with a level 10 AD carry with a Blade of the Ruined King. He's got 1600 gold to spend here as well. Means that someone may just get caught out, and that someone may just be Edward. He's actually going to come around. Woolite is going to spot him there, but not looking for the fight.
Yeah, it's really interesting because if you looked at those gold numbers a moment or two ago, Darien is only a couple hundred gold behind Youngbuck, but the rest of the lanes are mostly ahead. You know, 600 ahead for Diamond, 1,200 ahead for Nick. 80 carries are even support, 300, it's not massive. So Gambit as a team are somewhat ahead. Now Kauntar's being jumped on.
Kauntar being jumped on, the Q from Diamond will land, but the teleport did get started by Youngbuck. He actually cancelled that one there, so not joining in with that little party that was going on in the middle lane. There was no tower there for Kauntar, so he knew that he had to use a very early wild growth to make sure that he could survive that.
I think just to keep himself alive, which is key. Unfortunately, Copenhagen Wolves forced to blow that teleport summoner spell. So now Youngbuck can't afford to be caught out of position. And considering the importance of movement in this bottom half of the map because of the pressure Gambit have put on it, it does mean Young Buck needs to be very aware of what his opponents are doing. Darren is looking like he's going to build in Athenes and Holy Grail, so it's going to be a different kind of build on this Kayle than we're used to seeing. And finally, he's moving top, but he's, you know, a level behind. He's 40 CS down. Really need to keep our eyes on how this matchup is going to play out.
Well, also has intervention, so probably isn't even worried about Young Buck. Can keep his distance onto him there this entire time, kiting with a slow and his own speed up. Should he need it from that heal? Diamond did just come around for a bit of a look in after Edward had cleared out the wards there by Blue, but nothing really to do there. Just want to look at the AD carries again for all that time that Woolite had free in the top lane. He's actually behind in CS now to Genja.
Yeah, Genja was farming very well. Genja was under a lot of pressure from Copenhagen Wolves. There was pressure on the tower. He roamed for Dragon, etc. But he has been doing well last hitting. Got himself that Bloodthirster. I do think it's going to take him a little more time to hit a scary point. Count on an Airwax. He's just going to zone away Edward. Woolite has not roamed. He's not looked for those ambushes that we've come to expect from Twitches. And after 20 minutes of movement around the map, there's been so much importance on wards and vision. Copenhagen Wolves now, all of their wards are defensive. They're anticipating Gambit getting in their jungle. Let's see how Darren deals with this. By walking away.
A spectacular escape there. A couple of steps forward.
It's not something I've always said, like that.
Well, that is true as well. So, obviously keeping his cool this time around. He's got Edward there for a bit of support. He's going to have Diamond as well. This is a position where the Copenhagen Wolves may need to be little bit cautious as to what happens. There's a lot of CC between the three of them. However, wards were already down in the tri-bush. No wards down here, though, as they push onto
me. They're going to catch Kautard.
Kautard is way down the lane. He's going to speed himself up. There's the kick against the wall. Have they got the damage here to finish him off? It's a flash from Kautard to get him out of safety. That would have surely been death because the Zenith Blade would have landed from Edward.
Yeah, very well-timed flash to get away from Edward's Zenith Blade. Diamond actually did a pretty smart decision. Using the Dragon's Rage to knock Kautard into the wall guaranteed the Sonic Wave connection, which then guaranteed the red buff to be applied. So, pretty smart combination of events. Unfortunately, the commitment of members in the mid lane has exposed Gambit's bottom outer turret, and Woolite and Unlimited grab the third turret of the game practically unopposed. They pushed the top lane. Darien offered very little in the way of resistance. And Moonlight and Unlimited just keep farming and moving around looking for those objectives. So, the last outer turret for Gambit is in the middle.
Staying out of harm's way, really, as Woolite this entire time. The attempted four-man dive was thwarted nicely by the Copenhagen Wolves earlier. We have hit the 20-minute mark, so let's take an overall look at proceedings here. Still waiting for this first blood. This can actually be real dangerous for Kautard. There's a slow coming down. The polymorph coming in, and Darren says, I'm going to keep going onto you in this one, but Kautard, a couple of levels above him, still able to do enough damage to force him off. However, Diamond is coming back around the side. Will be spotted early enough by wards here, though, from the Copenhagen Wolves, and we'll walk back out.
So a couple of levels and an item advantage. I did like Darren's patience. He only committed to the fight once that first Glitter Lance had actually been used. Which obviously mitigated a lot of damage. But Darien still trying to find his way back into this game, I think is the best way to talk about it. He's gone for an unorthodox playstyle, and he's gone for an unorthodox build from what we're used to seeing out of Kayle's. But Copenhagen Wolves haven't really been able to respond. Copenhagen Wolves have taken advantage of Gambit's misgivings. So Copenhagen Wolves have got three towers because Gambit have not been there to defend in real force. Gambit have got Dragons out of the deal, and they've been pushing Copenhagen Wolves around the map. So the question is, do Gambit eventually start plugging these holes? They gave up a massive amount of turrets against Fnatic, but still won through absolute Dragon control. We're seeing a somewhat similar game developing here.
Holding here on position. There is a ward in the back of the pit from the Wolves. Have that Dragon pulled right out to the neck of its pit, and I think it's going to go down too quickly for them to be able to stop it. There is the Dragon pickup TP from Young Buck, will bring him right to the front of things, and actually he's going to dive on through. That's a great four-man solar flare at the back from Eddie, but is it enough to actually keep him alive? There's a lot of focus coming his way. He will have to flash as the calling comes through as well. Edward still being chased. There's the bomb finally coming out, and the Copenhagen Wolves now will have to back away. They've already lost one man. His first blood onto Air what's going to Genja.
That could have been so different if Darien did not cancel his teleport. Copenhagen Wolves were split up once they got into the jungle. Not everybody could make it over the wall together. So Gambit, on the retreat, just used a lot of very good abilities. That four-man solar flare from Edward did so much work in helping his team out. Genja gets first blood, a bunch of assists down the rest of the board.
Oh.
And Diamond, unfortunately, missing some key skill shots. Last week, it was the similar on Elise. He didn't hit as many cocoons as we're used to seeing out of Diamond.
Still got time to impress us this game with those. And already, to be fair, good against Karazhan earlier. Into the wall. See, a lot of damage coming through. And now the burst that we're used to seeing out of a Kale from the mid lane, or at least the masses of attack speed, not really coming through this time for Darien because of his build. Got more Snail Kale build.
Snail Kale, indeed. It will take a long time for Darien to be terrifying, but what is great is just how much headroom Gambit's composition does have. As Kale continues to, you know, make up the CS that he's lost, he's going to become a lot more powerful. He's going to have the tools, like you said, the intervention to help out Diamond when he goes for those insect-style kicks and goes for those engages. Youngbuck is doing a pretty good job. He's rushed a Banshee's Veil as his very first item, and when you consider the ability power threat from his opponents, it does make a lot of sense. And he's actually running a little scared. He's not looking to duel Darien. The rest of Copenhagen wants to see him in the lane.
Well, we all know how that ends when there's a Ziggs on the other side. Throws down his ultimate, and that wave is all of a sudden gone. That one close to connecting onto Kaltar. He did have unlimited. Just waiting off to the side there to give him a little bit of backup.
Look at the mid lane.
There, White actually coming around from the side to jump away with the satchel charge was used. Edward, though, going to be hooked in here. This could be bad news for Edward. Intervention used, they turn it around. And now Unlimited, the one that will fall. It's Diamond that picks up that kill. But will they be able to get any more from it? Doesn't look that way. Youngbuck's had to walk all the way down from the top lane. Will dive right into the middle of them. But that may cost him his life. He's going to get Wild Growth onto him. Will he fall? He's still alive at the back. Wolight has managed himself one, which will give him the double. And Airwax lands a cocoon, but doesn't have the damage. And now Nick flashing over the wall, bouncing bomb lands. Brilliant from Nick.
So at the end of the day, it trades a 2-for-2, if memory serves. The middle lane engage started pretty well for Copenhagen Wolves. They caught Gambit out of position, but the solar flare not hitting the strongest number of people. Good re-engage from Youngbuck. This is now the second half of the fight. Had Youngbuck maybe had a little more HP to work with, that could have done well, but that was a 3- or 4-man knockout. And Woolite just very sneaky from the back line, cleaning up on Twitch. Gambit have the potential to find picks and find kills if those solar flare connects. Part of the reason they didn't win the team fight outright is because of the fact that Edward Solar Flare was a little focused on shutting down Woolite and protecting his teammate. So a good counter engage from Copenhagen Wolves.
Impressed with how Nick controlled himself during those fights with the use of that satchel charge. Seemingly spent more time in the air flying away from danger than anything else. Darien also got himself finally up to that 100 CS mark. Still leaves him a chunk of gold behind everything though. Got himself the Stinger now in on top of his Athenes on Holy Grail. Starting item that he went for. There's going to be a Randoins though on the other side for Youngbuck.
So I want to highlight just the differences between Youngbuck and Darien. Darien just hit level 12 this second. Youngbuck is currently level 13, about a full level ahead. If you look at the gold difference, even though there is 60 CS separating these two players, the gold is only 600, which is a lot less than what it would be. 60 CS would equate to a lot. Oh, that's Darien caught out. Maybe.
Using the intervention, Woolite actually gonna try and get in position, and he will manage to get it. And the intervention not enough there to save Darien, as Diamond and Airwax having an altercation down by the red buff area as well. Little bit of a scrappy skirmish game this one.
And because Darien is so far behind in items and has this unorthodox build, he's able to get 1v1 that easily by Woolite. Woolite just snuck up in him from behind. I actually am not even sure if Darien had a rune on and Nash's tooth, if it made a big difference, because Woolite's got a lot of CS under his belt. But Woolite needs to make that work more for him. He needs to find more of those kills, because Genja is equally powerful. He's slightly less kills, but is equal on CS, got that static shift built up, got that bloodthirster, so he's going to be hitting like a truck once he gets that last whisper completed in a few moments' time.
A lot of ward fighting going on in the bottom side of the river, and good calls because Dragon will be coming into play again here in less than half a minute's time. Gambit already in position for that. They're going to push up that bottom wave. They've already got control of the middle waves and even getting some deep vision down as Genja throws an early culling out to try and get them back.
Yeah, and again, it's just to control. Because Dragon is so close, Gambit are playing a little more focused around the objectives, especially the Dragon. They're looking to get just absolute and utter control of this area. They have done so since the opening minutes of the game. And look for Nick's Mega Inferno Bomb. If Copenhagen Wolves group up, Nick may just use this to zone and grab Gambit another Dragon. Copenhagen Wolves are so hesitant to engage because of how poorly the last fight went.
Another solo player coming in. They've actually gone on towards Kaltard. Edward maybe a little bit deep for this one. Youngbuck diving into the middle as well. Edward falling low but doesn't go down. Darien though having to use the intervention on himself, but there's a lot of damage back. Couple of low men on either side of the table, and the dragon going down, but no one following him.
No kill secured. Nick still has his Mega Inferno Bomb available. He's playing very safely with it, and Gambit still looking to re-engage. They're scaring the Wolves away. They've got themselves a healthy gold lead, and the shred from Darien's Kale did a pretty good job. Youngbuck dove into the team and took a whole bunch of Kale auto attacks. Darien even got away from that fight alive, thanks to that intervention.
Well, the siege comes in. We all know how hard that can be against a Ziggs, who's got a death cap now, a second blasting one on top of his Athenes, and Gambit able to just bully him away from what was left of that inner turret. All right, stealthing up though here. Will he be able to find anyone? I don't think so. Going blind into the jungle is not something you want to do.
No, never. It's not worth the risk. Even with the amount of damage and items Woolite has, he could just run into a whole bunch of members. And this very interesting start to the game has actually led to giving Gambit a very healthy lead. Even though you've got this sort of awkward Kale, because of Kale's abilities, the heal, the movement speed, the slow, and the intervention, even when you're behind on gold and items, you are still effective, you are still useful in a more utility kind of way. And I think Gambit have done something unique. Whether it's good against other teams remains to be seen. But fact is, at 30 minutes, they've got a 6,000 gold lead. They've taken every single dragon, and they're bullying the Wolves around. So you can't deny it's working in this matchup.
Working for them, and at the end of the day, that's all that really matters. If you're fighting on a match-to-match basis, that once you are, those special plans that you put together get you a win at the end of the day. Maybe not something that you can do two times in a row, or as you said, maybe against the top of the table teams, but a win is a win, especially when you're sat tied up with the Copenhagen Wolves in seventh position. But game's not over just yet. We're only 30 minutes into this one. We've seen bigger swings in gold.
Yeah, we really have. And I actually still prefer Copenhagen Wolves' team fight composition. Once Siobhan and Elise jump in, Lulu Wild Growth is going to be so disruptive. And Thresh can peel and protect for the Woolite all day long. The only thing Copenhagen Wolves need to ensure they avoid is those multi-man solo flares, because if they do get caught, it's all on Edward and all of his charges to make something happen. They caught Darien, but I don't know if they really want to commit to this fight. We'll find out.
No, Hook and a Cocoon, although he's forced to use the intervention. Youngbuck at the back going low. There's a Wild Growth coming around. The bomb will absolutely blast the Wolves down. Genja steps forward. Nick is right at the front. He got hooked. Will flash, but not getting away from the damage. And the Wolves are turning this one around. Woolite wasn't able to finish anyone off. But look how many glowing red health bars we have. Gambit back away. It ends up in a one for nothing.
Gambit were not able to get the focus on the right targets. Because Copenhagen Wolves had all of that mobility and movement and, the Wild Growth to save people, they were able to get away. The teleport coming out from Youngbuck is going to keep him back in the team fight. And that Copenhagen Wolves with a good counterplay. Unfortunate for Gambit that even with a good re-engage and a strong use of that intervention, it was them getting hooked that started that whole chain of events. I do think with slightly better targeting on the key champions on Wolves, they may have come out in a better situation.
Leaves us close in terms of kills and in turrets as well. So the gold advantage lying with Gambit, though they've demonstrated great control over the dragon itself, and also keeping tabs on the vision that they put down entirely in the Copenhagen Wolves jungle. This blue buff has been warded for what seems like a good 15-20 minutes by now. Nick is actually going to go over to his blue and see that one is already taken away from him, and that won't be able to pick that one up. So we move into a slower pace of in game. So let's have a look down some of the items, because we have seen some big ones coming in for Youngbuck. Got himself that Randuin's on top of his Banshee's opening. The AD carries somewhere to really touch on, because they've got most of the farm in this game. The Phantom Dancer and the Bladed Rune King completed fairly early. We're going to see a solo flare, but flashed away from Unlimited.
I'm going to take a look at the items and the gold and the kill spread. If Gambit are able to kill Warlight, there's no damage really elsewhere on the map. Kowtod can do well with his death cap, but once his Glitter Lance is down, there's not a lot more burst. Because Youngbuck has not gone for a Blade of the Rune King, and Airwax has gone for the tank elise, not the spell pen or the damage elise, it means Copenhagen Wolves are banking on keeping Woolite alive. So I retract my earlier statement of saying that a five-man solar flare is going to be important. It's Protect Woolite that's going to be so incredibly important. Youngbuck, Airwax, and Unlimited have to provide enough protection and enough crowd control to keep Gambit at bay, while Woolite just lays the smack down, because he's got an incredible amount of damage to work with. That Phantom Dancer, BF Sword, Blade of the Rune King, and Last Whisper means he can tear through anybody on Gambit that's not interventioned. Whatever the ability. Yeah.
Intervention.
Yeah, hit with intervention.
Exactly. We all knew what you meant. It's all fine. We've got less than 30 seconds again until another dragon comes into play here. And those mid points being reset right in the middle. We'll see who's going to get control. There's really not a lot of wards down there at the moment. Gambit with the real soul 2 on the bottom side of the map, inside of the Wolves' jungle by the Wraith camp and by the red buff camp as well. But the Wolves have already pushed Gambit a little bit further back there. We see the Baron wards already being exchanged between the two teams, and the Wolves now starting to move down towards Dragon.
Yeah, we'll see if Wolves can actually secure this. Nick, Diamond, have real steel potential with that Lee Sin and with the Mega Inferno Bomb. Because Woolite is just so well farmed and fed with kills, he's gonna solo Dragon before anyone from Gambit can respond. And this is the first time the entire game that Gambit have not made an aggressive play for the Dragon. They are gonna steal a blue buff. I still think they need to get more wards. We've seen Gambit pushing around Copenhagen Wolves map so extensively. If you look at the vision right now, there's not a whole lot on the minimap for them to work with.
More walls for Gambit being taken away. They're on the top side of the map here, and there's another one put right down on top of them as Diamond lands his Q onto Unlimited, but not really wise to follow that one through at this stage. And I think the Wolves going to group up as five and push right back.
Yeah, even if Gambit wanted to fight, Genja wasn't there. Genja was forced to go top lane to shove that wave back and get rid of it. Genja's done a pretty good job this game of being with his team more. It's something that we criticize him of quite frequently during the spring split of farming. Oh, they've caught Darius!
Oh, Darius. Said intervention would be good for him, but didn't quite get it off that time. CC chain coming in onto him, and he will go down without anything to offer. That leaves the Wolves with a 5v4. 35 minutes in, 30 seconds spawn time on Darien. Do they think about Baron?
And they shouldn't, because of the fact that they have to deal with Ziggs. Because if they commit to Baron, they're going to take all of that AoE damage. It is very, very risky. They can bait it, though. If Copenhagen will stop Baron and peel away for the fight, that could be their way to get more objectives. Let's see how much damage Nick can land down. Mega Inferno Bomb could be used just for the poke, but that's going so low so quickly.
Lot coming in, but the calling from the side also causing problems. They've managed to hook Diamond, and there's a follow through from Unlimited, but he may actually die from this. He will be finished up. The bomb goes onto Wolite at the back. Diamond actually flashing away. Here comes Darien back into the fight as well with the teleport. Diamond has come back in. He may pay the ultimate price. A double kill coming out for Wolite. There's another one. Darien for the second time in less than 2 minutes falls as well. Genja's trying to find Youngbuck, but he may just fall down himself or not. He's got a lot of damage here. Gets one. Woolite has finished off Nick. Genja, though, still running through, does get one back. Well, that is a 4-for-2 in favor of the Wolves.
4-for-2, and like we talked about, the Copenhagen Wolves had a comp that needed to peel away for that one. They couldn't take extended periods of damage from Nick. Nick got a pretty good Mega Inferno Bomb onto most of the members of the Wolves, but unfortunately for Gambit, they simply didn't have the numbers required. By the time Darien's teleport had finished, the rest of the team was backing away. Genja has the culling available. He's going to look for a kill, maybe even the Baron, or not. Run away.
Thought he was gonna try and
no vision. Oh, even that vision.
Yeah, try and be the hero there is what I thought. Wasn't quite the case, but he's the start of that fight again.
So the key again is just Unlimited with a good pick. Unfortunately, full Gambit, Unlimited gets pulled right into the middle of the team. he gets a great box down, and by time Darian's teleport finishes, the rest of Gambit on retreat, and there's the protection we talked about. Woolite gets the Wild Growth, he uses Summoning Heal on himself and actually very aggressively flashes forward looking for the kill. As long as Woolite is alive, I don't think Gambit can win team fights, so I need to be so careful. And look at that, crit. Just, Woolite is just so strong. 8-0-1. Well done, Fantasy Points.
That was close as well. Diamond coming in just to get a ward down, guys, and almost getting hooked away. Safeguard just to get out of danger. But Baron on the Copenhagen Wolves here, still actually, funnily enough, behind in gold overall. We'll see what they can do with this Baron buff on them. We always talk about how hard it is to get past a Ziggs, especially one that's got himself a death cap, got himself the Void Stab, the Athenes, and now a Zhonya's Hourglass as well.
Because of the comp that Copenhagen Wolves have, they've got the option to just dive onto him. Mm. They can just throw Shyvana or Elise onto that back line, use the Wild Growth from Lulu, and then Woolite can just wait for his moment to jump in there and find a pick. I'd love to see Woolite grab himself a Guardian Angel next because of how important his damage is to the rest of his team. But the Copenhagen Wolves, they're looking to play the map game that we've seen Super Hawkcrew play fairly well. Put pressure on multiple lanes, force Gambit to respond. There's no teleport on Darren. Remember, he did use it in the Baron pit a few minutes ago.
Average game time of both teams, and Gambit about 3 minutes slower, funnily enough, than the Wolves. And it was the Wolves that we talked about last split that were really struggling to finish off games, even when they had massive leads. And it was Gambit who we thought were, you know, one of the stronger teams. When they get an inhibitor down, when they pick up a Baron, they just charge on through and win the game. But funnily enough, it's the Wolves this split that have that advantage. As Woolite split pushing here, trying to get himself in there. Ooh. But look at the damage coming out. Intervention was used, but really wasn't needed. And they take down Woolite and may look for more.
That was so good from Genja. If Genja can get onto Woolite, you can see how quickly you can kill him. The problem now is, can Copenhagen Wolves defend without their primary damage source?
Glitter Lance was the key there to stop Unlimited being picked off. The Q from Diamond didn't quite have a range. Zenith Blade was off range as well, but Gambit actually charging down this mid lane.
Yeah, but they know they've got the numbers advantage and they do have the engage potential from Edward. This is gonna be an inhibitor turret at least. If they stick around for the inhibitor, they need to be very careful not to get engaged upon. The peel from Thresh and the potential poke from Lulu is good. But again, there's no damage. There's no damage on Youngbuck. There's no damage on Airwax. Their only damage sources is Kowtar's Burst. He doesn't even have a Lich Bane yet, and Woolite. So without Woolite, Copenhagen Wolves are a little in trouble.
Especially if he gets blown to pieces like that last little. Well, this wasn't even a fight, was it? It was simply either of those two. Genja going straight in there. It was Darian who gave him the much-needed intervention, we're going to call it, at the end to keep him alive. And now the Wolves actually trying to turn this one around. Kowtar going to be moving through. Elise will rappel off to the minions. Have they got the range? That's a good solar flare to slow down two of them. But Edward may be in trouble. The Glitterlands comes across the side. Youngbuck will dive into the middle. Wild Growth going to be used as well. They need to get onto the back, though, because the damage from Genja and Nick is absolutely immense. Edward will fall. They can probably kill off one more. That's a max range cocoon. Darian goes down. The bomb from Nick gets one back, though.
They end up trading two for two because the Copenhagen Wolves took too long to get Woolite in play. Gambit, while on the retreat, put a lot of damage down. Nick, his bouncing bombs were melting through the Copenhagen Wolves. Woolite now wants Genja.
Want some revenge, I think, after got destroyed down in the bottom lane. Not today, though, or certainly not yet in this game. Wolves backing away, and certainly an interesting turn of events. The Wolves picking up Baron, Gambit getting one kill and pushing through and taking the first inhibitor of the game.
Yeah, that's going to give them a lot of presence on the map, which should, in theory, allow Gambit to make plays for the next Baron. Or alternatively, look to control those side lanes. There's only two inner turrets still standing for the Copenhagen Wolves. Darian has just completed himself a Lich Bane, so there's not a massive amount of ability power for him to work with, but it should allow Gambit's team comp to actually take towers and objectives even quicker. He's going to have all of that attack speed, his range from his Righteous Fury, and obviously the on-hit that Lich Bane will provide him. But it is still a very interesting pickup. Darian's Kale has been hit and miss in different team fights. It's worked in some circumstances. The previous one, for example, his intervention didn't offer a whole lot. Kenja may actually be able to 1v1 Youngbuck, because he's got so much damage to play with.
I don't think he'll need to 1v1 in the rest of Gambit. Starting to close around Diamond. Will actually be the first man to come in. He's going to kick him away from the safety of his tower. Now they've just realized that Woolite's there as well. I don't think they want that fight.
No, they definitely don't. In order to dive Woolite under the tower, Gambit needed to be close and knit, and they simply weren't grouped up well enough to go for that. No Dragon's Rage kick from Diamond. He was moving through the jungle, get some vision down in the top half, and we'll need to see how quickly he can rejoin. Unlimited wants to get the death sentence down, but the disengage from Ziggs is very effective.
Yeah, really good minefield there to slow the two chasers. Getting in. Meanwhile, red buff spawning on the wolves' side of the map. Diamond already on the way to picking that one up. His vision of it from the wolf side, but while he's in that rush, can't do anything about it. Diamond able to steal another buff. The question now is, will he get caught out by Woolite?
I think so.
Going to come around the corner. He gets a slowdown. There is the Blade of the Ruined King used, but actually backing away as he sees the rest of Gambit coming in.
Very smart play from Woolite. The risk of chasing into the fog of war is obviously not something Copenhagen Wolves want to do. And if you look at the vision, Copenhagen Wolves have got very defensive wards just above the current position. There's no other vision on the map for them to work with. So Gambit are going to be relying on the heals from Kayle and then Athena's and Holy Grail to keep Diamond healthy while the super minions do the work on the Nexus tower.
Yeah, they're going to have to back away here. Someone from the Wolves is going to have to back off, or all of them, which seems to be the path that they've taken. But they've already lost one Nexus turret. The second one is being hammered away on as well here. Oh, not because we are going to see that one saved.
Inhibitor
either way,
Gambit,
yeah, Inhibitor did spawn. I wonder where the health bar went, as we are going to see Unlimited get on, but he's going to surely go down. Knocked into the rest of the team. Airwax there in the middle. Youngbuck dives in as they pick off Edward. That's a one for one up till now. There's Nick jumping away again, and Gambit being ripped to pieces here. Genja will fall. Can they get any more back? It's a crazy, crazy fight. In the end, 3-2 in favor of the Wolves.
3-2, the Wolves are able to keep Woolite alive while running down members of Gambit. Nick is now caught out.
Oh, he's going to try and... I'm not sure he's getting away. Oh, that was a nice little Zonyas, but will he go down straight after? He gets the kill, but he will fall to Youngbuck in the end.
The question is, does the inhibitor go down? The minions from Gambit have been bashing away. The middle inhibitor has actually fallen. So Gambit's minions have reset. Super minions are pouring down the middle lane. If we look at the top lane turret in a moment, the minions have been doing so much work. Even though Gambit came out worse for wear in the team fight, 4-3, the fact that they've got super minions and almost got that tower does mean they come out ahead in objectives. Super minions are going to continue pushing the middle lane, and I think Gambit are going to start playing around Baron.
Baron is in there, of course. The Wolves taking the first one of this matchup. Gambit themselves are now 2,000 gold in the lead overall. We actually see needlessly a large rod coming in from Darren. So he's, as I said, the snail Kale build is finally getting to the position where he's going to be blowing people up. And that is a scary, scary thought for the Copenhagen Wolves. Granted, they did well in that last team fight. Youngbuck become so tanky in this one that he can dive in there, but the damage still can get through him if he's going a little bit too deep, which has been possibly in the last couple when he dives right to the...
I really would have liked to have seen a Blade of the Ruined King on Youngbuck, give him some damage to work with, so when he jumps into a fight, he can do something. Unlimited has got the help of Kaltar, but they're about to run into the entire Russian team because the Baron is the objective that we've talked about. Super minions are being controlled by Woolite, and thanks to their very aggressive play, Copenhagen Wolves have got vision control of that area. They haven't cleared out all of Gambit's wards, but they've got a lot of vision down themselves, so that's going to give them the information that they need to play with. The important thing to note is how many kills Gambit secured, even while losing Genja. Even on the retreat, they managed to get three members of the Copenhagen Wolves while losing four. So Gambit, because of their multiple sources of damage, they're not as reliant on Genja staying alive in these fights.
Here we go. We see Edward going in. That's a great playback from Unlimited, stopping any signs of a fight really from kicking off there. It's that minion wave with the super minions, of course, now that that enemy went down again. It's going to be halted at the mid lane, midway point. As Edward again gonna get hooked. Have they got the damage to finish him off this time? Intervention already used. There is a solar flare. We'll lock up to the bomb. Will follow through as well. They don't get a kill just yet, but Youngbuck slowed down. The spider goes flying back, and now Youngbuck still back in. Edward gonna be hammered away. They need to deal with Woolite here on the side, and there is the dealing with Woolite. It's Genja that comes in. Intervention used to finish him off, and now they may be able to follow through. Diamond gonna go deep onto Airwax, but he finished off himself. 3-2 for Gambit.
Yeah, but very importantly, Genja with his Guardian Angel and all of the damage is still alive. If Gambit are able to get onto the top lane, they should be able to get the top turret or potentially go for that last standing Nexus turret. There's only one left available. The team instead decide to go back potentially for Baron. There are three damage sources here available. Deny that objective from their opponents and look to win the next team fight. In the mid lane, it was all about Woolite. Gambit were able to re-engage even though Edward was the one that was caught out. And because they killed Woolite, straight up won the fight. Countdown's gonna try and interfere. I think he's gonna be so careful because he could get bursted down by so many members again.
However, Darien is gonna have to back away from this one, and there is the kill onto Baron. Airwax is gonna come across the side, but that's a suicide mission for him. The kill goes over to Genja as well, who's now 9-1-3 overall, doing a fantastic job here on the Lucian.
Yeah, very, very well played by Genja. He's just farmed his way into the game. He's been well positioned in every single team fight. The previous fight that he died was just because Copenhagen Ghouls committed so many resources and Kowtar got some great glitter lances onto him. But I do think Copenhagen Wolves just invested so much in Protect the Woolite and they can't reliably do it every fight. And now we'll need to see how they defend against this Baroned up, a couple of the Baroned up members of Gambit, because they've set their sights on the inhibitor, which is exposed. And remember, the top lane turret is very, very low. So if Gambit get any sort of presence there, they can immediately go for it. But look at the minimap, minions in favor of the Wolves.
Darien with that Lich Bane on, and the rest of the team now joining in will shred through that inhib. No real problem for them there. Where are they gonna go next though? As you said, top lane, low turret, which has been regenerating for quite a while. It looks like Gambit may even want to try and squeeze the Wolves back into their base completely. Let's not forget that one Nexus turret already went down earlier on.
And you contrast Gambit's style of play now to Super Hot Crew in the previous game. The minions have been in favor of the Wolves, and that's allowed Youngbuck to just teleport top and sneak away a turret. If Youngbuck had committed to the inhib, it may have opened Gambit to go for a backdoor of their own. So Mega Inferno Bomb used to clear the wave. You can see that on the minimap. Youngbuck, we'll see if he can get away. He should. Gambit have set the sights on Dragon. A bit of an awkward passage of play, but exposed inhibitor for Gambit. If they make big mistakes, Copenhagen Wolves do have a way back into the match.
And that might become a second one. Look at this, the Wolves going up towards his top lane. Woolite will be the one to show himself. There's three men there. Only Edward actually has come back to defend so far. So this turret looking like it's going to go down.
Yeah, it really does. We do see Genja Woolite though. Here comes Gambit.
They're throwing a lot onto him. Here comes Genja finally. Woolite instantly down to half HP. The box going to be thrown in there. Nick knocking everyone around. And here comes Darien from the backside. Well, couldn't follow too far through on that one, was hit with the Glitter Lance. They do a good chunk of damage. Don't get the turret though.
I really would have liked to have seen Woolite maybe getting a few more hits onto the turret instead of the minion wave. May have got that a little lower, maybe even secured it. But nevertheless, Copenhagen Wolves still showing some strong map play. Teleport is down from Youngbuck. Darien's used his teleport as well. And the Wolves are not out of the game, but they do have a lot of work to make up, a lot of ground to make up. And if they can keep surprising Gambit with their movements and their tower pushes, that's a definite way to bring themselves back into this game.
Always need to keep an eye on that mid lane though. If they lose focus of that, we saw what happened earlier on when they lost focus of it, and that was all around the inner turret on the bottom lane. They lost the Nexus turret for it, and even the inhibitor straight away afterwards as that had respawned. The minion just went off and took it down once again, but Genja can't knock his positioning so far today. 425 minions to his name, 9-1-3 overall. Guardian Angel still to be popped.
Yeah, I agree. And I think had either team had more wards to work with, they could have done more of those previous pushes. We'll touch on that in a second. Edward is going to get caught.
He's going to get caught. Do they have the damage to finish him off? Tanky by this time of the game with that Randuin's in there, and I don't think he does. Gambit now pushing through that middle lane. The Wolves are all coming around the bomb. They need to react quickly.
Yeah, I don't know if they can get in range. There's only one tower remaining. The rest of Gambit look like they want to set up a final siege here.
Super minions coming through. There's the calling news at the back. Youngbug going to dive in. Wild Growth going to be thrown on top, but I think Youngbug might be picked off before the rest of the team could come around. Airwax is up there as well, but Genja can do the damage as they do follow through. Diamond gets that kill for them. Unlimited gets the hook on Darien. He uses the intervention on himself. Well, that's already one man down. They're having to back away. They've lost the Nexus turret as well. Gambit surely got the damage here. They finish off one. The Nexus signal now with a focus. Kowtar has to flash away. I'm not sure they can finish it off, you know. Woolite has come back out. Youngbug has come back out. There is Kowtar. He's going to fall to Genja. And surely Nick will be able to finish off Woolite. Scans at the end. Gambit get the ace and finish off the Nexus.
Very exciting game. Very interesting game from the get-go. The Snail Kale build ending up 0-7-11. I thought intervention might have helped Darien a little more than maybe it actually did in the game. But I think that was a much more objective-focused Gambit than we've become used to seeing. And that early game advantage just crippled Copenhagen Wolves. They invested too much tank across the rest of the lanes.
Yeah, a lot of tank, and we made that point a couple of times that where was the damage coming from? We saw from Kowtar that he had that initial burst, but there was no real follow-through. Woolite had to be there for them. Woolite had to be doing the damage. He was full-build by the end with the Zephyr. Picked himself up a Banshee's Veil for a bit of protection. Infinity Edge was in there with a Phantom Dancer and everything you would possibly need he had. But if he gets focused down quickly, what are you going to do?
It's a 1-13. It's something that CLG North America was very guilty of last split. They would run protect the double lift comps, protect the AD carry comps, and it theoretically could work. But unfortunately, there was so much damage down the line of Gambit and enough engage from, you know, range from Ziggs, engage from Lee Sin, engage from Leona, that there was tools that Gambit could use to get to Woolite. And every time they did, they won the fight. Every time they didn't, they lost the fight. It was that simple as the game progressed. But I really think there's going to be a lot of talking points for those first 20 minutes because Gambit legitimately said, we don't care about top lane. Kind of worked out, though. Like, it's so weird to say, but it kind of worked out.
Well, I didn't expect it to because Woolite is there alone farming with literally zero pressure on him. In the bottom lane, Genja, it was a 4-3 or 2-3 or 2-2 for pretty much the entire laning phase. And funnily enough, he came out level in CS throughout that entire pressure phase. Also want to give a well-deserved heads up to Edward because some of those solar flares were definitely game-changing.
Yeah, I completely agree. The little bit of the curveball with the top lane Kale as well, you know, it threw me for a loop. I thought it was support first, ended up going top lane. And, you know, locking the engage in was the one thing that the composition was lacking from Gambit. Mm. And every time he got caught by Unlimited, they just instantly turned the tables. The Zenith Blade into the Solar Flare. But what I really, really liked from Gambit was just, I think, the recognition of we need to just focus Woolite. And that's all they targeted, all they tunneled on every team fight after the 20, 30-minute mark.
Nick as well finishing 5-3-13 in that. And we saw one fight in particular in the middle where he was bouncing himself around constantly. I think there were three satchel charges in a row, which actually got him out of range of dying. And Nick has really grown since the start. If you remember all the way back to his 0-0-0 Nidalee performance, where he just didn't really do anything, he's definitely come on as a player.
I completely agree. I do think this game as well, somewhat hesitant maybe in the early game with those Mega Inferno Bombs. It's not the longest of cooldowns, but you can't critique because it did end up working very well. He got the damage down in the necessary times and helped his team secure the victory.
Well, we are going to check in with Shox and Deficio, who are ready to talk to Gambit's Nick after that win.
Thank you very much, Joe. We indeed have Gambit's now permanent mid laner Nick here with us for the first time at the interview desk. Congratulations on the win. Let's take it back to the beginning as there were interesting picks coming out for you guys. How much of a plan was that going in?
Yes, I think we actually picked everything we wanted and like it transitioned really well.
I have to ask about Darien. In the early game, he actually went mid lane with you to just 2v1 against Kowtar. What was their tactic there?
Yes, actually, Darien is like this crazy top laner. It could be only him to come up with this tactic. Like, I watched him doing this in scrims, and it was really good. So, like, when we have Ziggs, who is already strong mid laner versus Lulu, and we have Darien coming to support me, Lulu was pretty much shut down in early and mid game.
Darren with the tactic.
Yeah, it seems like you've already fit in the team really well, if you're saying those things. How has it been generally stepping into this team with a lot of players that have been playing together for so long and being the new force?
So it's really great because I was always like big fan of Gambit, and right now I can play with them. I don't know what can I say. Like, it's really good.
It's pretty good, actually. And how is it then to play in the LCS now?
Yeah, it's good too. Like, I have been playing for the scene quite a long time, so it's really a great experience.
Well, it's great to have you here as well. Thank you very much, and congratulations once again. And now let's head back over to Joe and Quickshot to take a look at the table.
Thank you very much, guys. And with half of week three complete, the numbers have changed, but the table pretty much still looks the same. So let's have a look at it. Alliance remain at the top of the table with 6 wins and 1 loss. And SK Gaming and the Super Hot Crew both sit in second with a tie at 5 wins, 2 losses.
Now, likewise, Fnatic and Millennium remain tied for fourth, although they have now been joined by Gambit. And all three teams have a 3 wins and 4 losses record. Copenhagen Wolves have moved down to 7th place alone at 2-5. And Rocket is still in last position, but solo now at 1-6, searching for a leveled up performance.
Ties across the board, just like we like to see it here. And we have, of course, more action coming your way on Friday from the LCS. We'll begin the day with Gambit versus SK Gaming, followed by Millennium taking on the Copenhagen Wolves.
Yeah, after that, the Super Hot Crew will face Alliance, and then Fnatic takes on Rocket. And after our matches conclude, the European Challenger Series quarterfinals will resume with H2K Gaming versus SK Gaming Prime in a best of three.
And that all begins tomorrow at 6 p.m. Central European Summer Time, which is 9 a.m. Pacific. But right now, it's time for today's European Challenger Series quarterfinal as Denial Esports take on Lublin Shore. So guys, take it away.